We pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful opportunity, and please bless us this evening as we preach your word, as we listen to it. Let it run swiftly and fulfill your will. We ask in Christ's name with thanksgiving. Amen. Lord's Day, or Sunday evening, the 21st of August 2016. A godly person hates, comma, and therefore strives against all sins. Part 3. We already spoke about the darling sin a lot, and that people have a besetting sin, a darling sin, the sin of the bosom, the sin that they protect the most, and they will do everything to protect that sin and to fend off all that is wrong, in all arguments, in order to defend that sin, because that is the sin to which they are most enslaved. We spoke about King Herod, the sin of incest, the sin of loving the wife of another man and keeping her to himself. And when John the Baptist spoke to him about it, he lost his head. He was beheaded. And he did many things as he listened to John the Baptist, but he kept his master sin. And therefore he never became saved, because he clung to his master sin. The rich young ruler clung to his master sin, his besetting sin, the darling sin of his life and his heart. Love of money and love of earthly things. And when the Lord Jesus told him what he had to do, he had to relinquish that in order to deny himself, in order to be able to follow Christ as the Lord and his Savior and Master. He became very sorrowful and he left, and Christ didn't call him back, because he knew those who cling to their master sin are not the ones who are the elect of God, and they all go to hell. Because we read in James 4 that friendship with the world is to make yourself an enemy of God. Because we also know that Matthew 6:24 is true. No person, no man, no woman can serve two masters. You will either hate the one and cling to the other one, and vice versa. If he clings to his love of money, his love of sexual sin, he will deny and hate Christ and not cling to him, not be able to cling to him. Nobody can sit on two chairs. You can try. Maybe somebody will get it right. But two masters you cannot have and serve. This is the negative side of things. When I have until now spoke about those who are not regenerate, not saved, but the truly saved, the good, truly godly, those whom God has truly created anew, are the exact opposite. They do not have a master sin. They do not cling to any sin. They have been delivered from the enslavement to sin, and they hate their sins, and they cling to Christ as the only master and Lord and Savior, and they serve God in this way. Although they stumble into sin, they do not sin willingly or on purpose. That is the total contrast and difference between the godly and the ungodly, between the righteous and the unrighteous. Another master sin is some people love family members, maybe one family member or more than one family member, more than they love God and Christ. And as long as they cling to this master sin, they can never be saved. Luke chapter 14 and verse 26. Luke 14 and verse 26. Let's read verse 25. Now great crowds accompanied him, and he turned and said to them, verse 26, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. If you would not love your brothers and sisters more than you love Christ, but maybe your mother, or not your mother or your father, or your earthly brothers and sisters, but your wife. You cannot be Christ's follower. Do Christ, are all Christ's true people and God's all true people followers of Christ? Of course the answer is yes. They are all followers of Christ. So you cannot follow Christ, meaning you can never become my disciple, my follower. You cannot never be truly saved and start following me and continue to follow me after getting saved, having gotten saved. And the Lord Jesus said one has to count the cost in order to decide whether you will be able to follow Christ and then call upon the name of the Lord in order to be saved. After you have counted the cost. The context, the next verse, verse 28. For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? 29. Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him. Verse 30, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. They bring very great dishonor upon the name of the Lord, our blessed Lord Jesus Christ, by making a hasty decision. I decide for Jesus, never having counted the cross, never having realized what price it will cost them, never having really decided from the heart and calling upon the name of Christ to enable them to do that. I put you first, I put myself last, I put my mother last, my father, my brothers, my sisters, I put all earthly friends last, I put my own life last, my own desires, my own wishes last. You will be the only Lord and Master, and therefore become the Savior of my life, and I will in practice show that you have become my Master and my King. So let us understand this, that nobody who is enslaved to one darling sin will ever enter into heaven. It could also be or, not only and. You only need one, need to love one of these more than you love Christ. Instead of hating these things, in order to love Christ, put him first and therefore the Heavenly Father as well. And you will never enter into the kingdom of heaven. The godly person hates all idols, all darling sins and all accompanying sins. And he really denies himself in regard to all these things. And he says, Christ is all. He is my only Lord, my only Master, therefore my only Savior, my only King. And he shows it in practice. When he has to make the decision, my wife is not for me, will I still come to this church? Because I believe this is where I hear the truth. You will put Christ first and your wife last, even if you're going to have experience here, hell at home from your wife. Because she will be against you maybe. I have come, the Lord Jesus, to bring a sword. Bring warfare between a man and his wife. And between him and his family members, and a man's own family members will be his enemies. Christ came on purpose to bring this warfare, and this is the test that every person has to pass in order to show that Christ has indeed saved him, that God has indeed created him anew, according to 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 17, and has made him into a godly and righteous person, and that all old things have passed from his life, and that all things have indeed become new. Now, King Herod did not pass that test. He listened to John the Baptist, and then he did many things. He changed some things in his life. And these people are oftentimes willing to change certain things in their life, but they do not put Christ first. It is as if they want to bargain with God and think, I will do this and this and then I will impress him. But if there any sin remains in the heart, the darling sin and the accompanying sins, you're on your way to hell and you will remain on your way to hell. As Herod was, as King Saul was, as the rich young ruler was, whom we spoke about. Let us now talk about the sin-blinded and sin-enslaved, lost, unregenerate religious leaders of the Lord Jesus' time, the scribes and the Pharisees. Luke chapter 7, I hope I have the right verse here. I don't know exactly which verse it is, but somewhere in Luke 7. The Pharisees and the scribes rejected God's counsel by not letting them be baptized. Why did they, although they knew that they had to be baptized by John the Baptist, all the Jews, all the Israelites had to listen to his message? He was the anointed of God, the one who prepared the way for the Lord Jesus to come. Why did they not repent and get baptized? It seems as if their darling sin, their besetting sin, the sin of the heart, the sin that enslaved them most and entrapped them most and kept them from coming to Christ and first to John the Baptist, and why they rejected God's counsel regarding repentance and baptism, I won't say that is definitely their only besetting sin and their master sin, but if I study, as I study them, it seems as if the fact that they love to be seen of men and to be popular with the people, with the Jews, with the Israelites, was most important to them. And therefore they were a lot of hypocrites. A hypocrite who is dirty on the inside, polluted with sin on the inside, but tries to show a different face on the outside through their words and their actions. Matthew 6 and verse 5, in this verse we read the following: "And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites." He called them hypocrites by name. In other words, they did not have truth in their inner being, inward being. They were not genuine. They were not true. The inside and the outside were not the same. "Do not be like them." And then he described how they were. "For they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others." What a terrible slavery to sin. To go and stand on the up and pray in the synagogues of the Jews, and even outside at the corner, at the street corners. What was the motive of the heart? Because the motive of the heart, we saw many times, counts for everything with God. Because from the motive of the heart, everything else springs and flows. According to Proverbs 4, verse 23. "Truly I say to you, they have received their reward." This is the only reward. They're not going to be rewarded with eternal life. They're not going to enter into eternal life. They're still outside of the kingdom of God, and they will never enter it, and therefore never experience eternal life in God's presence. The only reward they have and will receive until the end of their lives is to be seen by men and to try and impress men. Impress Jews. "We are more religious than you. We are more religious than you are. Righteous than you are." What a paltry reward. To have that as your only reward, to have impressed the people a little bit, but there's nothing else coming. And the Lord Jesus said, you must do the exact opposite. You are genuine. You truly belong to me. You are truly godly people. Verse 6. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you publicly or openly. In other words, show that you are truly righteous. Because if your righteousness does not receive the righteous exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall never enter into the kingdom of heaven. Then you are not godly people. God's people, true people, are not hypocritical. They do not pretend to be something on the outside through their words and their actions. Even with regard to praying and fasting and giving money and so on. They do not do that. They're the same on the inside that they are on the outside. And once a Christian will have discovered that he has been a little hypocritical, the Holy Spirit convicts him of that sin and he makes right. Even oftentimes with the people. Because he hates all his sin, because as God has given him a new heart, a new inward motive, a new inward disposition, because God truly gave him the master love, namely the love to the Heavenly Father and to Christ, according to Romans 5, verse 5, he cannot tolerate the sin of the heart to be hypocritical. And he wants to be genuine, wants to show that he is upright and righteous. And in Matthew 6 and verse 1, we have also this. Beware, the Lord Jesus warned his true disciples, who are all godly men. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people. Am I supposed to practice my righteousness before other people, yes or no? Of course. Let your light so shine before men that they shall see your good works and give honor and glory to your Father who is in heaven. Of course we should practice our righteousness even in front of the people. We cannot only pray in our rooms. Privately, we must also pray in public. We should also give money in public. We should also help one another in public. But the difference is the motive is pure in the case of the godly, of the truly saved. Let's therefore continue with the sentence in order to get the full meaning. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people. In order to be, here the motive comes, in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. In other words, your motive must not be, I'm going to give more money in order to impress the people and show them that I am such a liberal person. Your motive must be to please Christ and please the Father. Show that you have been enslaved to them and their love in a wonderful positive way. Even if we practice liberality and help the needy and the poor, the same. Verse 2, thus, an example here, thus when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you. You see, the Pharisees would always make sure that the people heard them well and saw them. Ooh, we must be impressed. He gave 10 times as many as the other person. As much as the other person. Do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do, in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. They want to be seen by the other people. They want to impress the other people. They want to have the other people to have a good impression of them. And they even want to be praised, to receive praise from the others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. For the rest, they will die, suffer in hell. But you do the exact opposite. This is what a godly person does. Because God has created him anew. Verse 3. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Do not blow a trumpet and tell everybody every time I've given so much money and try and impress them. Verse 4, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. He knows that your heart is pure because he knows that his Spirit has been working in your heart all the time, even after he had created you anew, and therefore you gave out of love to Christ. What should the motive be when a person does his work or her work in the workplace? The Apostle Peter said, there are good earthly masters and there are wicked and evil earthly masters. Now, the worldling, when his master is near, he says, let us start working. He's going to see we're not working. He's going to give us some problems. In other words, the motive is not pure. They only work in order to avoid problems. But the truly godly person says, even when the boss is not there, I do my work because I do not, in the first instance, do my work for my earthly boss. I do it for Christ. And Christ is seeing me. He's seeing that I'm doing it for him. I do my work well here. And I'm using every moment when, even when my boss doesn't see me, the Lord Jesus and the Father in heaven see me. They see me. And I want to be rewarded by them on the day when I will stand before Christ, because I want to please him. I want to please the Father and the Son. So they hate, a godly person hates this darling sin that the Pharisees and the scribes had of really loving the praise of men. They could not take it not to be popular amongst the people. And there are so many people like that, they cannot take it not to be popular amongst their friends. And therefore they have to remain separate from Christ, because they love, the love of popularity is more important than the love to Christ. And in that way they show that they are godless people and not righteous and enslaved to sin. If I study the life of King Saul, I see the same thing. I'm not 100% certain that I have truly analyzed it genuinely and correctly, but it seems as if maybe that was also his darling sin, the besetting sin of his life, the sin that he nurtured the most. He couldn't take it not to be popular with the people of God. When the prophet said, I hear the sound of the bleating sheep and the lowing cows, etc., what am I hearing? The prophet was meaning by that, you know that God said you had to kill all those animals because they came from the enemy. And this time God said you must kill them all. You cannot retain any. Oh, but the people said this and the people said that and the people said the next thing. Poor King Saul was so enslaved to his darling sin, he couldn't take it not to be popular with the people. David was not that worried about that. He couldn't care less. As long as he could please God, his God, because he truly loved his God, whereas King Saul truly hated God. Although God had anointed him to fulfill his function as king, and don't forget, God was not in a good mood when he gave the people King Saul. He did it when he was very unhappy with them, and he said, the law of sowing and reaping is now working for you in reverse gear, in the sense that you were not happy with me as your king, and now I'm going to give you a king as you wanted, but you're not going to be sorry about it. And every time what the people thought was right. I never saw one instance in which King Saul pleased God and put him first, because he had an evil heart. Although God had anointed him to be king over his people, he never loved God. He was never a godly person. He never hated that sin of not being able to resist the temptation to be popular with the people, more than popular with God. And the scripture of James 4, friendship with the world causes a person to become an enemy of God. He never thought of that. And he remained in his sin, and that sin led to more and more sins, and therefore he went to the witch of Endor, and he did what he was not allowed to do according to Deuteronomy 18, etc., etc. And he was totally messed up by sin, and eventually God left him, and God sent an evil spirit to him. In contrast to King Saul, King David was totally different. He always wanted God to show him the sins of his heart, his motive. Show me, oh my God, whether my motive has been pure. And if you see something, remember, my God, in your light I see the light about your truth and about myself. Show me, because I want to make right. King Saul was always moving away into the darkness and tried to cover up, always had alibis and false arguments. Excuses, excuses, excuses. He defended his darling sin. David did not have a darling sin because he hated all his sin and he loved his God. And even after he had realized that the prophet had the point, you are the man. You got Uriah killed. You stole his wife, Bathsheba. He didn't defend himself. He started fasting, praying. He repented from the heart. And even after God told him, you can wash your face and anoint your face and be happy in front of the people because the child, I have already forgiven you, but the law of Galatians 6 and verse 7 will work for you in a negative way. Until the end of your life, the sword shall never depart from your family. And what hell on earth did he have? But instead of becoming rebellious because of that, he took it because every true child of God, of Son of the Father and daughter of the Heavenly Father, takes with a good inward disposition, the disposition of the true child, the chastisement of his father and the discipline of God the Father. And he didn't continue in that sin. He broke with it. Wonderful verse. In your light we see the light. About ourselves, etc., etc. Psalm 139, verse 39. Listen to this. Psalm 139. Cannot be. Where is that verse? Prove my heart and see whether it is, and know my thoughts. Does anybody know? He said, okay, it is 23. Verse 23, Psalm 139, verse 23. Search me, O God. So you need not to search yourself all the time. Some Christians are virtually all the time searching themselves and trying to analyze their feelings. That is for God to do it. Psalm 139, verse 23. Search me, O God. Don't try and do what God needs to do for you. And know my heart. By that he meant, show me what is in my heart. Search me. Try me. And know my thoughts. And then verse 24. And see if there be any grievous way in me. If there is anything in me that's going to cause me to go on the wrong track. And lead me in the way everlasting, in the way of your choosing. You see, that is how a true godly man shows, and a godly person shows, that he and she loves Christ and God and hates their sins. They want to know everything about themselves. They know that they many times sin the sins of with regard to sinning, they commit the sins of ignorance. They do not know about it. But you plumb the depths of my heart. Show me exactly what is wrong on the inside, so they can do it according to Proverbs 4 and verse 23. Make right from the inside. Ask forgiveness for my hypocrisy or whatever, and become totally honest and open again. And then from my righteous heart, continue with you in your everlasting way as you lead me in this way. A godless person, an unsaved person, an unrighteous person, a person that God has not created in you, doesn't pray like that. They're not interested in knowing about their secret sins, the sins of jealousy, etc. Let's now go listen to what the Apostle Paul said in Galatians 5, starting from verse 19. The works of the flesh. Galatians 5 and verse 19. The works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy. Jealousy starts on the inward, in the inward man, before you show it outwardly. A person can be jealous on another, upon another person without showing it for weeks and months. He can hide his jealousy for a while. Fits of anger. The anger starts in the heart. Rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy. Envy, an inward sin. In other words, the inward sins, the sins of the heart, eventually burst out into the open and are shown through the words and the actions, but sometimes it takes a long time before they get shown on the outside. So, only the true Christians are really concerned about the sins of the heart that other people cannot see because they want to please God. They know. Though the people cannot know it, I should know it. My Father in heaven knows it. The Holy Spirit living in me knows it. The Lord Jesus Christ knows it. And I do not want to displease them. I want to make right, although the other people will never know about it, in, as long as they are in this world. I'm now going to turn to 2 Corinthians 7. Or is it 1 Corinthians? Let me just check. Yeah, 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1. Very well known verse. Paul, the Apostle Paul, spoke to the Christians here and also speaks to us. The Holy Spirit speaks through Paul to us. Since we have these promises, he already had these wonderful promises of the previous verses. Since we have these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from every defilement of body and spirit. In other words, let us cleanse ourselves of every defilement of the outward man and the inward man. And in this way, fulfilling holiness to completion, bringing holiness to completion in the fear of God, in the deep respect for God. A godly man and a godly woman and a godly child shows that he or she really hates all his sins and really loves all God's righteousness, all God's commandments, and want to please God from the heart, not with regard to some things, but with regard to all things, that he really takes this command seriously. He cleanses himself from every defilement of both the body and the spirit, of both the outward man and the inward man, in order to bring holiness to completion out of respect for God. The lost people do not do that. How do we, should we show that we are truly saved, that he has truly made us, changed us and transformed us into being godly people? He enables us to hate every sin. The darling sin of my past and all the other accompanying sins, I hate every one of them. The sin of slandering, of breaking down people. The sin of speaking behind their back, breaking down their character. The sin of being worldly. The sin of not being focused on Christ with undivided attention and single-hearted devotion. The sin of having a cooled-off love to Christ and the Father, and not to have the proper love towards the brothers and sisters. And so we can continue and continue. The husband hates his sin that he is not a good enough father to his children and not a good enough husband to his wife when he sees the standards of God. In this regard, in Ephesians 5, verses 22 to 33, he says, "Oh my God, oh my Father, oh Lord Jesus, help me to fare better, to be a loving leader, but to be a firm leader, and to really, according to Ephesians 6, verse 4, bring up and nurture my son in the nurture and bring him up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Help me to do better." He feels very bad about all his sins, every single one of them, because the Holy Spirit in him, dwelling within him, is very holy and cannot take it. And therefore, the important matter is still, according to James 4, "Do you not know that the Spirit dwelling in us lusteth to envy?" I told you that again last time, and let us repeat it and emphasize this once again. You have a very jealous Spirit living in you, the Spirit of God the Father, the Spirit of God the Son, Christ, the Spirit of holiness, and he hates all unholiness and all uncleanness, and he will definitely make it known to you, and he will definitely make you feel very bad and miserable if you continue in that sin, and he will bring you to repentance if he truly dwells within you and help you to break with that sin, to bring it with sorrow under the blood of Christ, with true repentance, asking for forgiveness, but then also mending your ways and turning away from your sins and turning towards Christ anew. Wonderful to be like that. A word of encouragement to the Christians. Satan entraps the Christians, say, "You're a hypocrite. You're on your way to hell. You're not truly saved because you continue doing the same sin." But Satan doesn't tell him. The enemy is a master liar, the father of all lies, according to James, to John. And he says, and God's word says, if you battle against it and you make progress because you really fight against it from your heart with all the weapons at your disposal, even if it takes a little bit of time or even a longer period of time before you gain some degree of good victory, God knows that you're really hating it and you're working against it and you're closing off all the avenues through which Satan can entrap you. And that is to walk in the light. There's such a wonderful verse in Ephesians 5. Walk as children of the light. God has made us to be children of the light. And then also he says, the Apostle Paul, what has become manifest has become light. By making it manifest and evident so that not only God knows about it and Christ knows about it and the Holy Spirit knows about it, but we also know about it, that is already the victory to a great extent. Some people, some Christians do not fully understand what the apostle, beloved Apostle John meant by the statement in 1 John 1 verse 7. It sounds as follows. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sins, or better translated, continues to cleanse us on a continuing basis from all our sins. Exactly, brothers and sisters, what exactly does it mean to walk in the light? It doesn't mean to walk in perfection. You will only be perfect in heaven as you're perfect in with regard to your position in Christ, but you're not perfect with regard to your walk in Christ. You will not be able to be. But you do not stop being open with God, the Father and the Son. And I go for this meaning. I looked at many commentators, and half of them says, maybe more or less half of them says, if we walk in the light as he's in the light, we have fellowship one with another, meaning we as Christians one with another. That doesn't make sense to me. If we walk in the light as God is in the light, we have fellowship with him and he has fellowship with us. As long as I remain honest and open, as long as I acknowledge my sin, as long as my desire remains to break with that sin, as long as I fight with all the weapons at my disposal against that sin, I continue to have fellowship with God, my loving, wonderful, precious Heavenly Father and his beloved precious Son. Do not let Satan tell you because you have not gained the full victory, you're on your way to hell. Once you have gained full victory to 100%, you will suddenly find I'm not in this world anymore, I'm in heaven already. Because even Paul had that problem. He got so frustrated, whenever I want to do the right thing and fulfill God's law, evil is present with me, my sinful flesh, but it causes me to stumble. That does not mean, on the other hand, beloved brothers and sisters, that we should make excuses. We should really do our level best. And if you do not take the steps that you need to take in order to break with certain sins, you will be guilty before God. But he will chastise you. Even according to 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 11, he will not punish you, he will chastise you, he will discipline you in order to get you to wake up, but his love towards you remains the same and will remain the same forever. Isn't it wonderful, the marvel of having been regenerated unto a lively hope through the resurrection of Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ, from the dead, and to really know that Paul was serious because the Holy Spirit caused him to write that down. God was serious when he caused him to pen that down, that you shall never be enslaved to sin again. Therefore, you should see to it that you do not get entangled into sin. Break with it. But you will never be absent as your master again, because you will never be able to start loving your sin again. Your flesh always loves your sin. But your new man in Christ hates it. And therefore the Holy Spirit enables you to fight against it with might and main. So marvelous to know that we are pleasing Christ and God the Father in this way. A true Christian loves, hates all his sins. He hates the sins of sloppiness, of a sloppy Christianity. To do things in an unprecise manner. He wants to be disciplined, and therefore he works at it all the time. There's no sin that he calls a small sin. If somebody calls a sin a small sin, you can know you have to do with the last person. Because they say, oh, that's not a big thing. Call a person an idiot. I see it on TV every day, they tell me. I do not think a true Christian will speak like that. Because he knows that God says even the so-called smallest sin is very great in my eyes, because you're sinning against the living God and against your Heavenly Father, against your beloved Lord Jesus Christ. You messing up his image in your life, and you're supposed to show his image. That's the desire of the Father heart and the heart of Christ. So, beloved, let us continue in this way. And let me rather leave the rest of my sermon, and let us again let us end with a familiar passage of scripture, Hebrews chapter 12, that are so well known, that we have spoken about sometimes already. Hebrews chapter 12, starting with verse 1. How should we conduct ourselves in order to show that we are godly persons? Righteous persons. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, Which great cloud of witnesses, all the Old Testament saints, looking at us, observing us from the pavilions of heaven, seeing how we are running on God's spiritual athletics track in Christ and through Christ. And the witness that they bear us, it's more than worth it by infinity to put Christ and God first, because then you will obtain a wonderful salvation and all the wonderful accompaniments of that, even all the rewards of grace when you will be before the throne of Christ. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, this great cloud of witnesses means the many, many, many Old Testament saints, and not one of their testimonies was anything different than from fully in line with the other witnesses. They all bore the one witness. It pays to put God the Heavenly Father and Christ first in all things as you run your spiritual race. You can never lose out, because then the law of sowing and reaping works for you in a positive manner. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses of Old Testament saints, let us also like that, they did it, you should also do it, we should also do it. And he included himself. Let us also lay aside every weight, every unnecessary thing in your life messes you up and causes you, as the athlete of God, not to run as you should. And sin which clings so closely, it clings so closely, it ensnares us, it entraps us. And let us run with endurance, with patience, the race that is set before us. And in this case, not looking to the Lord Jesus, there's a reason why the author here said looking to Jesus, because he wanted to emphasize, look at the earthly Jesus, look at the man Jesus. He was God, yes. But in this case, I want to emphasize his humanity as a man, as a weak man, who sometimes were really weak, and after having fasted 40 days and 40 nights in the desert, his body ached like your body aches when you are very hungry, when you get a hunger attack. Look to the earthly Jesus as well, not to the heavenly man, the Lord of glory only. How did he conduct his life, the man, Jesus? Look at him as the founder of our faith. Look at him as the perfecter of our faith. And look at his example. And then he described Christ, the Lord Jesus' example, who for the joy that was set before him, the joy that he would experience in heaven afterwards, after he would have completed his race as he should have done it, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated now at the right hand of the throne of God. Our Jesus, the man, Jesus. That was not the only time that he called him Jesus. He referred, the author of the book to the Hebrews, referred to Psalm 8. What is man that you are mindful of him? God wants to set us over all things. He said, in the book of Hebrews, now we do not see that all things have been subjected unto man yet, but we see Jesus. We see Jesus. We see the man Jesus at the right hand of the Father, the man. And he has conquered, and he's the conqueror. And he's making us victorious as well. He really wanted, he had a pastor's heart, as a spiritual under shepherd of the Lord Jesus, and he really, really wanted to encourage them, spur them on to love and good works, and to really run the race without losing heart, without losing speed, without leaving your track, running in your lane according to the word of God, hating all your sins. Every time you see that the sin has started entangling you, ensnaring you, you break with it, and you put the Lord Jesus first. And you, as you look at the human, the man Jesus, and you say, Jesus, you made it. you're going to cause me to make, because your full name is the Lord of Glory. You're not only man, you're God also, but as man. That is what makes us so enthused about him. As a man, he conquered. As a man. And therefore, as a man, he had to be subject to his father. And he had to live in full dependence upon his father, and from every word that as a man he received from the mouth of the Father, heard from him. This is the way, beloved, in which we should show that we are godly people, and that we hate all our sins and strive against all our sins and strive for righteousness, to the glory of God the Father and the Son, and we please him in this way in a wonderful manner. The others displease him in such a way that you can hardly describe it, and they're going to suffer forever for that. But be grateful and go for that. Praise unto his everlasting and glorious name. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, enable us to live in this way. Know that you have, according to 2 Peter 1, already given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. And let us really trust you every step of the way. Let us live as the man Jesus lived, by living in the power of the Lord of glory, Christ Jesus, in order to please you, Heavenly Father, as your Son pleased you. Let us please you as well. We thank you that you created us anew. We are very, very grateful. Enable us not to lose speed, not to lose heart, not to lose our forward momentum and thrust, and to please you in all things. As God's people said, Amen.